for reading in the library. Those nine kids to be accomplished.
Can you believe that? And they took him to jail for sitting in the library.
They were jailed for 2 days. This was 1961, a time when challenging racial law meant risking your life. Joseph Jackson, the one who asked to check out the library books, says he remembers being scared those 2 nights in jail.
There it is. Legendary keys.
Somebody, the Klan or somebody, will come after them once they got out. That was 56 years ago in Jackson's city. At the time, it was a catalyzing event for other students to join the civil rights movement. But the read-in itself, that event, has been almost forgotten. But as of now, if you visit the old Jackson Municipal Library, you will see this.
Shield.
That's a new marker funded by the Jackson Library Board in honor of the Tougaloo Nephew.
Piece of
at the bottom, it says
shit.
A library sit-in inspired activity by black youth across the state to integrate public parks, swimming pools,
crap,
stores, and movie theaters. This has been a tough last few days in terms of our national conscience and dignity on very difficult issues related to race. But this new marker in Mississippi, which the library raised the money to put up, and just in recognition of what those nine kids did that day in that library for themselves. Come on. Best new thing in the world. And you know you need it. It's true that what happens in national politics affects the whole country. That's why it's national. But it's not just the stuff that happens in the White House that happens everywhere. Sometimes what happens in the rural corners of the country affects all of us too. Best new thing in the world today. That does it for us tonight. We will see you again Monday. Now it's time for the last word. The great Ali Belshi is in for Lawrence tonight. Ali, it's great to see you. Thanks for being here.
Rachel, thanks very much. I learned a lot in the last hour. Have a great weekend.
Thank you very much, my friend.
All right, well, it's over. Steve Bannon is out of the White House, back at Breitbart, and apparently ready for war.
Steve Bannon is officially out at the White House.
Take him up to
Steve Bannon was the heart of darkness on the White House. Controversial from the very beginning.
You know, I've been running a little hot on occasions.
The entire senior staff had basically turned against him. And frankly, the president had turned against him. We'll see what happens with Mr. Bannon.
Tonight, he is already back in charge
of course.
News.
He says, quote, the Trump presidency that we fought for and won is over. It's almost laboratory tests designed to enrage Donald Trump.
This man does not seem to me to have what we would normally think of as a soul. He has an open sore.
I think he's in a position right now where he is much more isolated than he realizes.
General Kelly can change the people in the White House, but that's not going to change the president's instincts.
He is the malevolent fury.
The presidency, that presidency, is over. Those are the words of President Trump's newly ousted chief strategist, Steve Bannon, just this afternoon. In an interview with the Weekly Standard, Steve Bannon was incredibly candid about how he views the Trump administration. Quote, the Trump presidency that we fought for and won is over, Bannon said Friday. Shortly after confirming his departure, he went on to say, we still have a huge movement and we will make something of this Trump presidency, but that presidency is over. It'll be something else, and there will be all kinds of fights, and there will be good days and bad days, but that presidency is over. And, quote, yes, you heard that right, Steve Bannon, the president's chief ideologue, who helped channel Trump's base and shape the nationalist policies that helped Donald Trump win the election, is now saying the Trump presidency is over after just 7 months. Bannon's departure is certainly a blow to the president, who entered the week with few allies and finished it with
who fired him?
Trump had to, but they say the whole staff was against him.
Even less is going to be accomplished without him. Bannon told the Weekly Standard, quote, okay, now it's going to be Trump. The path forward on things like economic nationalism,
yeah, right, immigration, and Trump, it's going to be all Trump. Okay.
His ability to get anything done, particularly the bigger things like the wall, the bigger, broader things that we fought for, it's just going to be that much harder. Think about that for a second. Bannon barely has his foot out the door, and he's already sounding off. The president now has an unpredictable and potentially troublesome ally on the outside now who's not afraid to criticize the administration that he just left. Like today, Breitbart News announced that Steve Bannon has returned as executive chairman.
Yeah.
And he even chaired the company's evening editorial meeting. Bannon is no doubt going to use Breitbart to amplify his complaints with the White House. According to Axios, Breitbart's operations are planning to go thermonuclear against globalists that Bannon and his friends believe are ruining the Trump administration. A source close to Bannon tells The Atlantic, quote, Steve is now unchained, fully unchained. I'll tell you more about that in a minute. The president has had an ongoing fight with the left since the start of his administration.
I don't understand how that, I just don't get how you, yours can be, you know, I mean.
11 days into this thing, and we have a president who is as isolated and weakened as Richard Nixon during his final days in office. So the question is, what happens now? Joining us now, Steve Smith. He's a Republican strategist and MSNBC political analyst. Jonathan Capehart, opinion writer for the Washington Post and an MSNBC contributor. And Will Hilton, journalist and contributing writer for the New York Times Magazine. He wrote the cover story this week, Down the Breitbart Hole. Gents, good to talk to you all. Thanks for being with us. Jonathan, let me start with you. The president has an ongoing fight with the left. He has developed a fight with the establishment conservatives in Washington ever since the failure of Obamacare. Now it appears he's picking a fight with the far right by getting rid of Steve Bannon. Where does this leave him?
Well, I don't know if he really is picking a fight with the far right by letting Steve Bannon go. It was interesting in the interview with the Weekly Standard. I mean, he's talking about the Trump presidency as he knew it being over, but he's going to take the fight to the administration. And in the later quote that you put there, that you know the so-called globalists within the administration, I think that's who he's going to take the fight to. That a lot of pressure from Breitbart News is not going to land on President Trump. He's going to, Steve Bannon, is going to train his fire on those people within the Trump administration he thinks are getting in the way of President Trump doing what President Trump wants to do. Now, the problem is President Trump is going to war with those very Republicans he needs to get that agenda through. You don't think Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell you don't think he remembers all of the mean, horrible things that President Trump has said about him? What the president doesn't understand, and I think, you know, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell said this, I think that was last week. So much has happened since he said this. That the president doesn't understand how things work here in Washington. If he wants the wall built, if he wants that budget passed, if he wants the debt ceiling raised, if he wants tax reform, if he wants anything to do with immigration, he can't do it by fiat. He needs the Republicans in both the House and the Senate to push that legislation along to get it to his desk. The president is at war with everybody, and Steve Bannon, now on the outside, is going to take that war to the people within the White House.
Let me take your choice of words over to Steve Schmidt. Steve, just after 3 o'clock, as this news, in fact, just before 3 o'clock Eastern, as this news broke, I was about to start a conversation with Joel Pollack of Breitbart. And Joel had just minutes earlier tweeted a single word in a tweet, hashtag war. Here's the discussion that ensued right after that. Is there an implication here that there is going to be a war that involves Steve Bannon versus the Trump administration?
I don't know. It really depends on the Trump administration. The key to the administration's success has been and will continue to be whether it sticks to the agenda on which Donald Trump ran for president. And in many ways, he has indeed stuck to that agenda since taking office in January. And the issues are what bind him to his base. It's not personalities. It's not even Steve Bannon. It is his performance on those issues. And those are issues that our readers generally want to see action on. If he pulls an Arnold Schwarzenegger and tries to reinvent himself as a liberal, he will see that support erode very, very quickly.
So, Steve Schmidt, where does this put Donald Trump vis-a-vis the Republican base of support, both in the public and in Washington?
What the editor of Breitbart saying that he's going to declare war on Donald Trump is the least of Donald Trump's problems. This was a week where we saw the collapse of all moral authority in the office of the President of the United States through the personage of Donald Trump. He's lost moral authority internationally as well. We saw the business community, part of the spine of the Republican Party, walk away. We've seen every CEO, we've seen evangelical leaders now. We see a president who is very, very isolated. And what we see really is the crack up of the coalition that elected Donald Trump. The fusion of the conservative party with this Breitbart populism. And during the campaign, of course, there were the dog whistles, the winks and the nods to these extremist elements that are now out fully in the sunlight. And so what Steve Bannon represents is a real fundamental test and choice for the Republican Party. The Republican Party cannot remain in coalition and survive with neo-Nazis, KKK, white supremacists, and their fellow travelers and apologists. There's no room.